2, 1, clear. All right, great. Good job, Woody.
Wow. I'm sure the guys with the cameras did a great job, but there's no way pictures can do justice to what I just experienced. I knew this was going to be a fun job. Actually, I spent a whole day training for this, and it cost several hundred dollars. And even though the risk associated with the jump was probably less than that of driving out here this morning, it's pretty clear that skydiving is not for everybody. But a lot of people would like to get the kind of thrill that I just experienced without spending the time and the money and the nerve. And that's the reason that amusement parks are such big business. And that's the reason that the designers of rides are always trying to outdo one another. We wondered how you would design a ride that was both thrilling and safe. So we spent over a year tracking the design and testing of what is, at least for now, the world's ultimate roller coaster.
Three or four major roller coasters open up every year. And in a never-ending competition to be the best, each is bigger than the one before it. Today, coasters can be 20 stories tall and reach speeds of 70 miles an hour. The coasters are designed to be safe, but their intimidating looks are beginning to scare off less adventurous riders, according to the designer of this coaster, Ron Toomer.
I really think a lot of people are going to walk up to that thing and they're going to look up there and they're going to say, my gosh, that's too big for me. I'm not going to get on it.
So 5 years ago, Ron began toying with a brand new concept in coasters. Here's how all existing coasters work. The twists and turns and ups and downs in the track create forces pushing and pulling on the rider. That's what makes them fun. But always the greatest force is pushing car and rider against the track, even when you're upside down in a loop. And that's what keeps you from falling out.
The center pull holds.
To demonstrate, we joined a high school physics class as they rode a coaster with their own homemade force meters.
One unit of force. This would mean that on your rear end, when you're in that car, you'd feel your normal weight. But as we go around the bottom of that curve, you're going to see this thing pull down to 2, 3, or 3.5 times your normal weight.
For the experiment, each student was supposed to look at and remember the force holding them into the car at different points in the ride. But it proved easier said than done.
Too scared to look at it.
We didn't look at it, we forgot.
Gotta do it again.
We made it easier for us to see by slowing down the action. Entering a loop, there's a force 3.5 times greater than normal gravity pushing them into their seats. Even when upside down at the top of the loop, they're being held into their seats by a force 2 times gravity. So at no point do they really feel as though they're upside down.
And you felt like you were on Earth rather than in a roller coaster upside down.
Didn't have a sensation of being upside down, except for the visual sensation of looking upside down. It felt like you were sitting right side up.
In all existing coasters, that's just as well. Otherwise, car and riders would fall off the track. Only briefly, at the crest of a hill, does a rider feel like he's coming out of the seat. But what if a coaster could be designed that did a barrel roll, like an aerobatics plane?
We're looking for an advancement of the roller coaster technology here that would allow us to feel more like that kind of a sensation. We're able to roll over, fly along upside down, and you really are upside down. You're hanging upside down, you look down, and there's nothing below you but the ground. There's no tracks or nothing there to hold you up.
It was this new twist in roller coaster design that Ron and his company, Aerodynamics, decided to explore. This is an early run of a quarter-scale model. To create the barrel roll effect, the car sits down in the tracks rather than on them, as in existing coasters. And to hold it up when it's upside down, it hangs from a second set of wheels. These are big innovations for a roller coaster. And when we joined Arrow in the early stages of development, there were still plenty of questions to answer. Like just how much initial energy the car would need to avoid the discomfort and embarrassment of a problem like this. The main task, though, was to stop people from falling out. The job of engineer Dahl Freeman.
Would you like to pull the restraint down now?
The challenge is to come up with a restraint system that holds people comfortably and securely, no matter what their shape or size.
Okay. It feels great.
And you
really
feel
secure.
More secure hanging onto the handles?
If we're going upside down.
We're going upside down.
I'll hold on.
Ideally, the restraint system would be adjustable to fit each rider. But the time that would take between rides would make the roller coaster unprofitable. This system works well for Cindy, an average-sized woman. But Bill, who's a little larger, would clearly have some problems. The lap bar is meant to fit snugly across his legs.
Obviously, this is not going to restrain his body and offer the support that he needs when this vehicle turns on its side or goes upside down.
Bill can be accommodated only by shortening the lap bar so it can reach his lap. Now the system works fine for Bill.
Okay, how do you feel?
I feel really secure. You know, there's no place to go.
But can it still do a good job on someone Dusty's size? Arrow's goal is to fit children 4 feet and taller. Dusty's 4'4".
Pull that down so it's tight. Feel good?
Yeah,
feel locked in. Okay.
The shoulder restraint only keeps him from falling forward, so it's up to the lap bar to hold him in.
Good. Things feel okay here?
Yeah.
Okay, your legs are tight. They look like they're good and tight. Your arms, you're holding on a little bit here.
Yeah.
Your head's clear. Okay. And you're off the seat, just a few inches. Let's turn him back up.
Freeman is increasingly confident his system will hold riders as different in size as Bill and Dusty comfortably and securely.
There's a partial compromise here. If I was setting it just for him, I'd probably move this lap bar in another 1 or 2 inches. But the way the seat is designed in the lap bar, we've got a range here where we can lock him in securely and as well deal with someone that probably weighs 4 or 5 times as much as he does.
Devising an effective restraint system was a problem they'd anticipated. But the first time they put a mock-up of an entire car on the track, there was a nasty surprise in store. Because the car sits down between the rails, when it goes through its barrel roll, the rear passengers are brought within a dangerous few inches of the track.
Boy, look at that.
Looks pretty close.
You know, we haven't had to deal with this before, and that the tracks have always been pretty well under the vehicle, but this track's coming right up around as we go through the spiral. And we're going to have to do some shielding here, some more shielding than we normally do. One thing I don't want to do is close this in as a canopy. You know, we've got to keep the vehicle open to maintain the thrill of the ride.
But in the end, a small rear canopy is the only solution to making sure hair and hands don't get caught between wheels and track. At last, it's time to erect the test track, 1/4 of the finished ride. The joins must be precise to avoid dangerous lurches. But even the greatest care doesn't mean the coaster will run as predicted. While expected speeds and forces were all carefully calculated, they were based on assumptions about wheel friction. And this is the first time a coaster has alternated riding on top and bottom wheels. If the friction is less than expected, the coaster will run faster than planned, maybe dangerously so. Which is why the first passenger won't be a person, but a machine, an accelerometer. It's much like the student's homemade force meters, but it records front and back and side-to-side forces, as well as up and down. 3 years after work began, the coaster is hoisted into position for its maiden voyage. The starting height is still something of a guess. If it's too low, the car may not pick up enough speed to make it around the track.
There's always that feeling inside, you know, what can happen that we don't know about yet, and maybe it'll end up just going back and forth right here in the dip and not make it all the way around or something like that.
The moment of truth. It looks like a perfect run.
This little penis area.
But were the forces recorded by the accelerometer in line with predictions? All seems to be well, even in the critical region under the line when the coaster is hanging upside down. So it's safe for a human rider. Who will it be?
Well, I don't ride them anymore. I get sick for one thing, and I don't like to go upside down for another, and it's just not my thing.
It's the engineers who'll take the first spin. After all, they built it.
Bring the lap bars down first. You'll have to tug on them a little bit and get the windows started. Okay, and then the windows go up.
See that? Okay.
Oh, well. Strength is next. You okay?
Yep.
Keep your arms legs.
All right.
Have a nice ride. Have a nice ride.
I think we're going to go.
From the sound of it, Arrows created the new thrill it was seeking.
This ride concept opens up a whole new dimension to us. And we can see, instead of the horizontal spirals, we can actually see a drop rolling. And we think that'd be wonderful. We see a high-speed spiral. Just exciting things in our minds, and they've got to be developed and tested, but I can tell you right now, they're gonna work.
That's it. Till next time on Scientific American Frontiers. Please, come on back and watch.
GTE brings you more than the power of telecommunications, light, and precision materials. A grant from GTE also brings you the power of a new world in Scientific American Frontiers. At GTE, the power is on.